You're listening to School Leadership Reimagined, episode number 13.
Welcome to the School Leadership Reimagined podcast, where we rethink what's possible to transform your school. If you're tired of settling for small wins and incremental improvement, then stay tuned to discover powerful and practical strategies for getting every teacher in your school moving towards excellence. Now, here's your host, Robin Jackson.
Hey, builders, welcome back to another episode of the School Leadership Reimagined podcast. I'm your host, Robin Jackson, and today we're talking about five books you should be reading this summer. Now, I am a huge fan of education books. Heck, I write them. But I also believe that as builders, we should be reading outside of education as well. That's why each year I make it my mission to read widely in other fields, searching for books that I believe can significantly impact the way that we think about education. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to share the five books I believe all builders should be reading this summer. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the book and explain how and why I believe the book speaks to the work that we do in education. Then I'm going to do something that I've never done before. Over the next several episodes, I'm actually going to apply the book to a persistent challenge that we face in education, and I'm going to show you how each of these books not only speaks to that challenge, but actually gives us unconventional ways to address it. So I am really excited about that. But before I dive in, I want to take a moment to thank today's sponsor. Today's episode is sponsored by my online training course, The Feedback Fast Track Formula. Now, if you've ever found the observation and evaluation process excruciating, particularly this year, if you struggled to get into classrooms and you were overwhelmed by the amount of paperwork that you needed to complete, well, then you need this masterclass. It's four lessons that take you through every phase of the observation and evaluation process, from strategies to get yourself organized, to the way to get into more classrooms, to how to use micro-slicing to get to the root cause of a teacher's practice quickly, and how to complete your post-observation write-ups quickly and thoroughly, and then how to have that post-observation conversation. In fact, it covers just about everything that you need to make the feedback process less of a headache and way more meaningful and impactful in teachers' practice. By the time you're done with this masterclass, you'll have an entire feedback process that's not only streamlined so that it takes you far less time, but it's boosted so that your feedback has more power and more impact on a teacher's practice. So you can learn all about how to enroll in the masterclass by going to mindstepsync.com/feedback. That's mindstepsync.com/feedback. Okay, now it's time for me to unveil this year's reading list. These are the five books that every builder should be reading this summer. Book number one, The Big Leap by Gay Hendricks. Now, I don't really remember how I came across this book. Oh, wait a minute. Yes, I do. I heard someone reference it on a podcast interview I was listening to, and I was curious, so I bought the book the next day. And from the moment I started reading it, I grabbed a notebook and I furiously started scribbling notes. There was just so much good stuff in this book. And it starts out by talking about how most of us have what he calls an upper limit problem. And what that means is that we often self-sabotage our success because we have an idea in our heads about just how successful we're supposed to be. And when we exceed that limit, well, it gets uncomfortable for us. So what we do is we subconsciously sabotage our success so that we can get back to a range or a limit that feels more comfortable to us. Now, we can stay there all day because I see educators doing this all the time where we self-sabotage our success because we don't feel like we should be successful. We have these altruistic kinds of notions about how far we should go and how successful we should be. And we do things that sabotage our success all the time. But that's not where the book finishes. There's so much more. You see, he also talks about how we all have what he calls a zone of genius. And that's where we're at our best. We're our best selves. And we do the work that we are uniquely gifted to do. And so what he does is he argues that we should be spending the majority of our time in our zone of genius. But There are also zones of excellence and zones of competence and incompetence. And more often than not, we tend to spend the majority of our time doing work at which we may be competent or even excellent, but that doesn't really represent our zone of genius. Now, this struck me. I mean, that stopped me in my tracks right there. And it stayed with me ever since. Not only do I see this all the time in my own life where I'm doing something outside of my zone of genius. Sure, it may be in my zone of excellence. It may be something I'm really excellent at doing, but it's not my zone of genius. And I also see many educators who are so used to operating in their zone of competence or even their zone of excellence, doing things that they're excellent at, but it's not their true zone of genius. And I honestly think that this is the reason that so many of us feel this slight sense of dissatisfaction with our work. And we don't understand why, because we're doing good work and the work is somewhat rewarding. And so we don't understand why we still feel a little sense of dissatisfaction. The answer is that we're often operating in our zone of excellence and not in our zone of genius. So I'm going to devote an entire show to this sometime in the near future, but trust me, this book is really eye-opening in helping us realize what is really our zone of genius and showing us how to reorient our entire lives so that we can operate more fully in our zone of genius and banish those upper limit problems for good. So it's an amazing book. Again, that's The Big Leap. All right, the next book is Influencer, The New Science of Leading Change, and it's by Joseph Grinney, Carrie Patterson, David Maxfield, Ron McMillan, and Al Switzler. Now, these authors are part of the Vital Smarts community. You can probably Google them, and they've got some great videos online. And these are the people who bought us a classic book, Crucial Conversations. But I have to tell you, this book is way better than Crucial Conversations. It's about how you lead a change effort. In particular, it's about how to change people's behavior. And I almost didn't include this book on the list because the strategies they talk about in this book are so powerful that in the wrong hands, it could be really dangerous. I mean, I'm serious. This book breaks down exactly how to achieve rapid, profound, and sustainable behavior change. Think about that for a minute. It's going to show you the secret. You could literally change people's behavior and change your organization with just a few simple tools, and they spell them out. The tools that they use are what they call the 6 sources of influence. And as soon as I read them, I got so excited because they align so perfectly with the will skill continuum that I teach. So like I said, I told you this book was brilliant, right? And what they do is they break down each of the 6 sources of influence and they show you how they work and how you can leverage them to create behavior change. It's fascinating. And then the authors use stories from real life change efforts to illustrate their point, and then they back up everything with tons of social science research. Their writing style is also really engaging, and their stories are so fascinating that they just, you know, it's almost like a page turner. They make everything so plain, it's so obvious that it's a fairly easy read, even though they're dealing with some pretty heavy stuff. You know, I couldn't put it down. And can I just tell you, I mean, if you haven't figured it out already, I love this book. I mean, when I first read it about, I don't know, maybe it was about 10 months ago or something like that, and I first read about the 6 sources of influence, it literally blew my mind. It was so clear. It made so much sense that I thought, this is the key to changing school cultures right now. In fact, it heavily influences how I teach about culture change in schools. Now, the implications for education are huge in this book. I mean, this book not only breaks down how to have more influence over those that you are building, it shows you exactly how to shift your culture so that the people in your culture consistently move towards your goals. So if you're struggling to move your culture forward, or if you have a big goal, but you seem to be getting nowhere fast, you need this book. I'm going to do an entire episode about it in just a few weeks. It's that important. It's awesome. The next book, number 3 on our list, is a book called Work the System, The Simple Mechanics of Making More and Working Less by Sam Carpenter. So Sam Carpenter was the owner of a service business in telecom, and he was totally burned out. His business was failing. He was working long hours just to keep things afloat, and he needed to do something different. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Anybody overwhelmed and burned out? Well, Sam was so burned out that he had to figure out something different. He was at the end of his rope. So what he figured out was he figured out a way to develop systems in his business. And once he did, he went from a literal 80-hour work week to working 1 hour per week and multiplying his revenue 20-fold. Now, I know that almost sounds too good to be true, but this book is about how he did that and how we can use systems to significantly lighten our workload while still making our organizations more efficient and more effective. And his big argument, which I happen to agree with, is that any organization is simply a collection of interconnected systems. So if you have a mediocre or a failing organization, it's really because you have mediocre or failing systems. And once you understand that, then you know if you want to change your organization, you need to look at and change the systems within your organization. The good news is that establishing and optimizing systems is really an uncomplicated process. So what he does is he lays out the exact steps and he gives really great examples and he shows you how to develop the right systems you need to build a more effective organization and save yourself a ton of headaches in the process. Now, what really resonated with me about this book is the shift in perception that it gave me. I mean, think about it. If an organization is simply a collection of systems, then if my organization isn't doing well, I can find the system or the systems that are the cause of it not doing well, I can fix them, and then my organization runs better. So I love the simplicity of that. Now here's something else that I've been thinking about ever since I read this book. He says that rarely do organizations have a people problem. If you think you have a people problem, look at your systems, and almost always you're going to find a flaw in the system somewhere that's causing the people problem. So if you fix the system, you fix the people problem. I mean, I love that. I mean, that resonates with me as a builder because the big excuse that I hear over and over again is that people think that they can't move their schools unless they get rid of certain people first. And for years, I've been saying, no, you can move your school with the people you have. Don't let the people in your school hold your vision hostage. But now after reading this book, I can show them exactly what I mean. So anytime now that I work with a school, they show me a people problem and I can show them a flaw in their system that if fixed would make the supposed people problem obsolete. To me, that's the biggest takeaway of this book. I got this book and the implications go beyond just people problems. Think about it. Your entire school is a collection of systems. And if something is not working in your school, it means that there's a flaw in one or more of your systems. So you fix the system, you fix the challenge. Now here's something even more interesting. A lot of times we're experiencing overwhelm or fatigue because instead of having a system for something, we're making things up every single time we do it. I mean, think about it. Most of the time, our discipline issues are very similar. In fact, I would argue that 80% of our discipline problems in schools can probably be divided into three or four issues at the most. And yet, every time a student is referred to the office, we make up our process from scratch. Guess what else? Every year, many of us make up our summer leadership team meeting agenda and our summer leadership team process from scratch, or we make up each and every staff meeting agenda from scratch, or we create every post-observation conference from scratch, or every year we are building our master schedule from scratch. What would happen if we had systems in place for these types of things, systems that could run without our direct involvement? Uh-oh, I just said something blasphemous. You see, leaders, they tend to be superheroes. They are the system in their schools. And that's why so many of you are so exhausted right now. What builders do is builders build systems. They make the systems the hero, not them, their systems. And when you do that, you not only make your school run better, you actually free up more time and more space for you to operate inside of your zone of genius. See how this is all kind of connecting together? So that's book number three. Book number four is An Everyone Culture, Becoming a Deliberately Developmental Organization by Robert Keegan and Laura Laskow Leahy. And I hope I'm pronouncing their names right. So this book was recommended to me by someone that I met at this year's ASED annual conference. And as soon as he told me about it, I downloaded it on my Kindle. And let me just read you the first paragraph of this book. The authors say, in an ordinary organization, most people are doing a second job no one is paying them for. In businesses large and small, in government agencies, schools, and hospitals, and for-profits, and nonprofits, and in any country in the world, most people are spending time and energy covering up their weaknesses, managing other people's impressions of them, showing themselves to their best advantage, playing politics, hiding their inadequacies, hiding their uncertainties, hiding their limitations, hiding. Whoa. Doesn't that sound like just about everywhere we've ever worked? And so what the rest of the book does is it explains a new model for how organizations can create what they call an everyone culture, where the entire organization is an incubator for people's development and for people's maximizing their full potential. So this book is not as easy to read as some of the other books on this list, but it made it on this list for two very important reasons. First, one of the underlying messages of this book is this: get over yourself. Allow yourself to be vulnerable. Create a culture where others feel safe to be vulnerable as well, so that everyone in the organization can become a better version of themselves. I mean, how could you not love that message? It's something that we all need to hear, especially in schools right now. Now, the second reason that this book made it on this list was chapter 6. Uncovering your biggest blind spot. Now, this chapter uses something called the immunity to change map. And by the way, don't you just love that title? The immunity to change map. Anyway, they use this map to help them figure out, or to help you figure out, your own personal blind spots that are keeping you from being your best self as a builder. And what I love about this map is that it can also be a great tool for helping you understand the blind spots in your school. So what they do is they describe it as having one foot on the gas and one foot on the brake. That's what normally happens. That's your immunity to change. So in other words, there are a lot of times when we as a school say that we want change or we want improvement, but we have competing hidden agendas or hidden commitments that put the brakes on our progress and keep us from reaching our goals. And I think it's really important that we unpack that. So I can't wait to do an entire show on this topic. So stay tuned for that. That book, I think it's a really powerful lens through which you can see your school and understand why so many people may be resisting change and how you can change your culture so that people are willing to take risk, to be vulnerable. And if you're ever struggling with staff members who are hiding, like that first paragraph that I read, then this book really shows you how to get beyond that, how it gives you the tools that you need to embed in your school to keep people from hiding and help people be more vulnerable and take more prudent risk in the service of advancing your school and reaching your school goals. All right, the last book on the list is called The Power of Moments, and it's by Chip and Dan Heath. Now, the Heath brothers have done it again. If you love Switch, which if you haven't read Switch, you need to go read Switch, because that book is on my personal top 100 most influential books. I think it's that important. You need to read it. But if you loved that book, then you're going to love this one, The Power of Moments. And in typical Heath brothers style, what they do is they examine the idea of what makes a moment a defining moment. And then they use research and all kinds of engaging, fascinating, gripping stories to explain how you can deliberately create defining moments. And it's really an enjoyable and insightful read that challenges your thinking. And personally, I found this book to be really inspiring. And when you read it, you're going to see the connections to education. They're so clear. So okay, I'm gushing a bit here, but can you tell how much I love these guys? And I really think that it's because, like me, they love Malcolm Gladwell. I mean, how could you not love anybody who patterns themselves after Malcolm Gladwell? Come on. But seriously, I was reading this book and I thought about the huge implications that it has for educators. I mean, how often do we intentionally create meaningful moments for our students? And for that matter, how often are we intentionally designing meaningful moments for our teachers? I mean, think about that. What would happen to your school culture if you intentionally created powerful, positive, defining moments around the things that reinforced your core values? I mean, I don't know about you, but my mind is already racing so much. And again, I'm going to do an entire episode about that in the next coming weeks. So those are my top five books that all builders should be reading this summer. And before I go, I just want to recap that list one more time, and I'll also make sure that I link to all of these books in today's show notes. And by the way, you can get the show notes at schoolleadershipreimagined.com/episode1313. All right, the first book was called The Big Leap. The second book is Influencer, The New Science of Leading Change. The third book was Work the System, The Simple Mechanics of Making More and Working Less. The fourth book was An Everyone Culture, Becoming a Deliberately Developmental Organization. And the fifth book, The Power of Moments. Now, these are some really good books that have personally had a big impact on the way that I think about the work that we do and the work that we're trying to get done in education. But look, I don't want to just give you a list of books and then say, go read them and hope that you get something out of them. So what I'm going to do is, over the next few episodes, I'm going to take some of these non-education books and I'm going to show you exactly how you can apply them to your own practice as a builder. So I want you to stay tuned for that. Now, in the meantime, I just want to remind you again about today's sponsor, which is the Feedback Fast Track Formula. It's a masterclass online. So if you are frustrated that your feedback conversations with teachers are going nowhere, or if you're looking for a system that really helps you get into more classrooms and give teachers feedback that they will actually act on, then make sure that you check out Feedback Fast Track Formula. And you can find more information about that at mindstepsinc.com/feedback. And as I do almost every single week, I still want to connect with you if we're not connected on LinkedIn. So would you please, please, please go to LinkedIn, find me at Robin Jackson, and send me a connection request. I would love for us to be connected. Now, starting on our very next episode, we're going to dive right in and talk about upper limit problems and how they actually get in the way of how we set our vision and write our strategic plan. So we're going to be looking a little bit more closely at The Big Leap and looking at how we can apply some of the big lessons of that book to how we create our strategic plan. And by the time we're done, you're going to be able to build your strategic plan like a builder. That's it for today. Thanks for joining me, and I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you for listening to the School Leadership Reimagined podcast. For show notes and free downloads, visit schoolleadershipreimagined.com. School Leadership Reimagined is brought to you by Mindsteps, Inc., where we build master teachers.